Hey there, I'm Darieth Chisolm. Welcome to Hustle and Heart TV. I am at the mayor's office here in the city of Pittsburgh, just wrapping up an incredible interview with Mayor Bill Peduto. And we talk about the state of entrepreneurship and small business here in the city. But he also gives me some brand new information about a new program that's launching here that will help to level the playing field for small business owners and entrepreneurs looking to get city and government contract work. So you definitely want to pay attention for this. Plus, he shares the wins and challenges of running his own business. This power-packed episode of Hustle and Heart TV up next. Like so many entrepreneurs, I'm drawn to the glamorous, gorgeous, larger-than-life, iconic ideas and outcomes that represent success. I'm amazed at just what it takes to truly be a standout, a rock star, a millionaire, a trendsetter. It ain't easy, but somebody's got to do it. So why not you? I know it takes hard work and hustle to make things happen, but I also believe it's a matter of heart. We can manifest our greatest desires with a little less sweat equity and a little more divine guidance. Plus, be equally inspired by someone else's life story. I'm Darieth Chisolm. I'm here to help you unleash, unlock, and bloom your dreams in business and in life. I'm a speaker, author, entrepreneur, life and business coach, media personality, and video podcast host. Every week, my team and I uncover dynamic, authentic, heartfelt conversations to help you leverage tools and resources, make more money, live the lifestyle of your dreams, become a rock star, and love your journey. Pittsburgh Mayor Bill Peduto, thank you so much for being here on Hustle and Heart TV. What an honor.
Yeah, well, welcome to the Mayor's Conference Room, Darieth.
Yes, I'm so glad to be here. Thank you so very much. We've got a lot that we want to talk about today, and clearly on this show, we focus primarily on entrepreneurs, small business owners, and it only makes sense that I really start with the question about the state of an entrepreneur or small business here in the city of Pittsburgh.
Well, it really depends upon the industry, but for the most part, across all industries, things are very promising. On the retail side, neighborhoods that haven't really seen much in the way of business districts are starting to be reborn, and those that have had an opportunity for mom and pop type shops are doing extremely well, the ones that have been around for a while. And you know, they weathered the storm, and it wasn't always good, and especially in neighborhoods that you would think that it would, the Squirrel Hills, the Oaklands, the Shady Sides, they had to go through down cycles, and now they're reaping the benefits of a better economy. Small tech firms and others are seeing plenty of work. There's a housing boom going on in this town right now, and you can see building permits. We're at an all-time high, which means people that are hanging drywall, people that are plumbers and are painters are seeing additional opportunities and benefits that just weren't here 5 years ago. So across the board, we're basically seeing an upturn in all types of small businesses. And I think that that's going to be a prolonged economic stretch.
Yeah, and so much of it, of course, is the spillout coming from the awful economy that we had a few years ago, and then obviously seeing this upturn and people choosing to come back to neighborhoods and open up small mom and pops and encouraging people to come to them. But we've also seen, obviously, the growth in technology in industries that typically weren't synonymous with what Pittsburgh business looked like.
Right. So you have, number one, like you said, the idea of moving out of the city into the suburbs and being in an office park environment or even a strip mall is not as attractive as being in a city and being in a neighborhood business district. And that's happening all throughout the world. That's not just happening in Pittsburgh or in North America. That's happening all throughout the world. There's more people living in cities than at any time in the history of this world. And more people as a percentage living in cities. So you see this desire to be in a vibrant urban area. And you're right, you know, it's not just that Google and Uber and Microsoft and Apple and Disney and all these large companies are locating, but what's happening is the spin-offs that are occurring by the people that are coming here and those that have an opportunity to do business with them. And they're happening in very unique ways. The robotics industry is working hand in hand with the Sheet Metal Workers Union because they have a skill that is able to give them the products that they need for the robotics industry. And at the same time, Carnegie Mellon University is teaching them how to become entrepreneurs and how to open up their own businesses. So it's a very interesting ecosystem of both innovation and entrepreneurship.
And Pittsburgh is ideal for that. When we think about the companies, you said, some of the larger ones that are coming into the city, but the mindset of so many of the young people here who are finding ways to build bridges both in technology and through small business and bridging that, this city is perfect for that in my mind.
Well, when I have people that visit, and they visit places like East Liberty or Lawrenceville or Southside or Squirrel Hill, and they look at the business districts themselves, the things that they don't see, Starbucks, Panera Bread, all the different big box that so many cities have, as really it's anywhere USA. What they see are the local mom and pop shops, and they've not only established themselves, but they've identified themselves with the neighborhoods. And that's what makes Pittsburgh unique. That's what makes, we don't think it, or because we just, if we feel that, but really it is rare in American cities to find the high number of independently owned retail stores that we have within Pittsburgh.
And it is so interesting because when I look at the Homewood area, when I look at Lawrenceville, parts of the South Side, and as you say, much of that is sprinkled with mom and pop, small, not retail chains, but stores that lots of people are flocking to because they enjoy having the opportunity to leave their home, walk around the corner, and have a very busy business district right in their neighborhood.
And you're starting to see it happen in places that you hadn't before. I mean, I like looking at what's happening up in Allentown. And a lot of the new development that's happening are the small stores and the small fronts that are coming in with entrepreneurs from catering businesses to tech to everything, really. And really, the impetus of that has been a grant program to help reduce the rent so that entrepreneurs can have those first 2 years with very low risk. We want to see that occur in Sheridan, in Manchester, and in Homewood, and start to give people that opportunity. Maybe it's somebody who works at Pep Boys, who always wanted to open up their own transmission shop and be able to give them that opportunity to take that risk. Maybe it's somebody who has created a really great scented candle and wants to be able to have a storefront to be able to do it. What we want to do is we want to partner with the risk takers, give them a very low rent for those first 2 years when a lot of companies either make it or break it, and give them the opportunity to make it.
Is that what we saw happen in East Liberty? Because, you know, that growth happened, what, over 5 years, and all of those business owners that were able to get in, did they have abated programs that allowed them to come in with low rent and then really spur a big economic growth in that area?
Some did, and the reason is you could put down a piece of yarn and attach it to the Cathedral of Learning and go in a 1 mile radius, and the moment you hit East Liberty, you hit a much lower rent, and it was still in the close proximity to the universities and the hospitals and the innovation where they wanted to be. And what had happened is a lot of sharing space was created, a lot of opportunities for innovation hubs that people could maybe have their own office or share an office or share a space so that that cost was even lower. I think Google putting their campus there also provided an understanding that a flag was planted, that this would be one of the areas. Where are you seeing it now? The Strip District, Lower Lawrenceville. That area around basically 24th to 32nd Street, a lot of different tech firms now looking at that, a lot of new development coming where larger international tech firms are creating their North American innovation centers. And I really think that you're, unlike other cities that have one tech hub, what you'll see throughout the city of Pittsburgh is it will be spread everywhere.
When you talked a little bit about these programs that are allowing small business owners to open up shop in neighborhoods and really and have either low rent or abated rent for a couple of years, is that enough to spur or encourage the risk takers, or what else needs to happen? Because it would assume to me that a number of people have great ideas about mm-hmm. starting a business, and there's always, of course, the startup cost and the risk, but is that enough, or what else needs to happen?
Well, the thing that has to happen is you have to have customers. So, I mean, that's the gas that keeps the car running. The programs that we're looking to create in offering low rent haven't been created yet. And we're working not only with the state to be able to help us to create it, but also with our large nonprofits, the universities and the hospitals. Getting a foothold in to the marketplace really depends on a couple of things. And it's number one, having a product or a service that people need. And it's number two, believing in yourself.
Yeah, and that is so very important. And I want to talk a little bit about why, you know, you government programs can be rolled out. There can be all types of initiatives and incentives. But if one is not really settled in that self-belief and that determination to keep pushing past all of the obstacles, it can be quite tough. So I'm sure you've got a lot to say on that. We'd like to pick up with that when we come back after this break, please, Mayor. Are you interested in learning more about podcasting and video podcasting and how you can build your brand, influence, and income through podcasting? I'd be happy to help. In fact, you can schedule a complimentary discovery session with me. Really simple. Just go to podcastingandyou.com. Leave me your name and your email. You might want to check out one of my upcoming trainings as well. Or simply send me an email at info@darieth.chisolm.com and we'll get some time scheduled to discover how podcasting can help you grow your business and your brand.
Welcome to the Pittsburgh Marriott City Center, where all of your meeting, events, and travel needs can be met.
Hi, I'm Stephanie Adams, Corporate Catering Sales Manager here at the Pittsburgh Marriott City Center. From the large corporate meetings to the smaller education seminars, I am your go-to meeting planner. I am ready to make your next event brilliant. From start to finish, you will receive the utmost excellent service, from fast response times, creative minds, and unique food and beverage. Contact me today, and I'll show you why we are ranked top 5 in overall event satisfaction.
Check us out online on Facebook at Pittsburgh Marriott City Center or call today at 412-471-4000 to make your next event brilliant.
Are you looking for a career that pays great money, working with a fun group of people? I know, sounds too good to be true, right? Hi, I'm Troy Miles of the Miles Group.
We will train you, help you get your license, even supply leads. No cold calling.
I've been here 2 years and earned 6 figures this year.
I love my job.
I love the freedom and being my own boss.
If you would like to work among friends, have a great time, and make good money, call us.
Find out more at tmilesgroup.com.
Hi, my name is Marsha Ambrosius, and I'm a singer, songwriter, and producer. And you're watching Hustle and Heart TV with Darieth Chisolm.
I always get so excited when I'm talking with entrepreneurs about the hustle and the heart of a dreamer, of an entrepreneur, because it really does take a lot of hustle and a lot of heart, a lot of loving what you do in order to be successful, no matter what the business is. Yep. And clearly you have to do that as mayor of the city of Pittsburgh. But when you think about the mind of an entrepreneur and the hustle and the heart and what it takes to just really believe in yourself, what is that like?
I can tell you firsthand. So back in the early 90s, I ran a company called Allegheny Political Resources. I don't come from a political family. You know, there was never a yard sign in my yard growing up. So there's a lot of politics is a family business, especially in Western Pennsylvania. So I had to try to figure out a way to get into the system. And for me, that was political campaign work. And starting out very young in college, you know, doing the phone banks and going door to door, coming out of school and getting paid $100 a week to be the gopher for a Supreme Court race and ending up in that race as the statewide field director and going down to Washington and working for a political research firm that was doing for the first time taking voting files at a local level and adding 50 different demographics on it, a subsidiary of R.R. Donnelly. And for the first time you could target voters based on specific information. I could find out if you had children, if your children were in public school, and then have a message directly to that household. I believe in increasing funding for our schools. That would be a way to get that vote. So our company was bought by a soft money pack in getting ready for the 92 presidential. I moved back to Western Pennsylvania. I created Allegheny Political Resources, and what we did is we used information and technology in order to be able to provide services to political campaigns. And I did that for a while. And I you know, had staffs of, during certain campaigns, of 100 people. I had to watch healthcare costs. I had to be able to provide different services for the people that worked, and also all the consultants that were in line that I was hiring. And at the end of the day, I had to have a client that was successful. They weren't usually successful. I took on a lot of underdogs. But the fact is that what drove me in that was my love for what I was doing. And I lived in places like Du Bois and in up in Mercer County. I lived right outside of Sharpsburg in Farrell, PA. I lived in Mill Creek in Erie. I lived all Somerset. I lived all over Western Pennsylvania doing this, and wherever there was a federal campaign that was targeted or a state campaign that was targeted in this part of the state, I was the person who was usually in charge. But it didn't get there from just wanting to do it. I got there from knocking on doors, from passing out literature, from working as an assistant to a field director, from being mentored by others, and then every day saying, I want to do this and I want to be my own boss. And that process took quite a while. And then at one point I decided, I really don't want to be in the politics, I want to be in government. And that's what then steered me to where I am today.
And you talk about what it takes every day to get out there and make it happen, no matter what it is, having a political company, or if, you know, as you said, you want to open up a Pep Boy. Mm-hmm. It's the consistent everyday action of believing in oneself and then taking those steps to become successful that really, at the end of the day, is the earmark for true success for an entrepreneur.
I think anybody who can wake up in the morning, go to work, and enjoy what they do is blessed. And most people don't get that. And if you have a desire and you have an ability to see that desire through, you're not going to succeed 100%. Nobody does. I mean, it's like baseball. You know, if you bat 350, you're doing really well and you're an all-star. But if you don't take a swing, you bat zero. So you have to be willing to take that shot to make it happen. And you also have to be willing to say that if it doesn't happen, there should be another route to go. It's not just trying to do it the same way every time, but finding the other way to do it. Look at my political career. I mean, in 2005, I decided to run for mayor. I was in my first term as a city council member. And the people said that, number one, I would get less than 10% of the vote for mayor. And number two, I was going to lose my political seat as a councilman. My career would be over. Well, we won 41 out of 43 precincts in the council race, and I finished second to Bob O'Connor with one out of every four votes, even though I spent the least amount of money. And that helped to set things up. In 2007, when Mayor Ravenstahl took over, all of a sudden my political stock had fallen to the bottom. And again, people said, his political career is over. And in 2009, I had three choices: run again for mayor, run for council, or run the heck away from politics. I chose to bide my time and to run for council. And then in 2013, put all the chips on the table. And no matter who it was that they were putting up against us, we knew we were going to win because we were dedicated. We had done the time. We put 6 years into planning and building alliances and doing the things you need to do in politics. It's the same way within business. Sometime it may not be your time. Sometime you may have the greatest idea and a really good service, but it may not just be the right time, and it may fail. But that doesn't mean to give up on that dream. Wait till the time is right. Come back and succeed.
Yeah, and failure certainly does not mean that it's the end all. In fact, it could be the opportunity to fine-tune something, fix it, and come back and be even better. Facing fear, facing failure, and moving forward, you obviously know that from your own political career.
Yep.
And as we talk about just examining that under the lens of being an entrepreneur, does fear and failure usually knock most people out of the game, in your opinion?
No, definitely. And I'll tell you what, when you're in it, it is horrible. When you're out of it and you've been able to get through it, you look back at it as like, to me, some of the best things that I did as a council member were at the times when I was considered to be failing, when I was considered to be on the outs of the political system, when campaigns weren't going the right way. But I was able to pass the most important legislation, do the most important things. In a way, even on the side stuff that I was doing, executive producer of a film, studying in Norway energy policy for a month, doing all these different, an interfaith peace mission to Turkey. all these things that I would probably have said, no, I don't have time for, or they weren't diversions. In a way, I felt that they were, but they were helping me to get back up when I was down. And you'll only know that you have done that once you have gotten out of the abyss, because you can't feel it when you're doing it. But here's the most important thing, because life is this, that when you're down, take a step forward every day. That's all you have to do, because eventually you'll be over there and you won't even know that you've made the journey.
Great. Well, we've got so much more to talk about, but what I want to focus on is perhaps some additional resources, because it's great that we can engage in a conversation that is really encouraging for someone who might be facing a fear, facing failure, or perhaps trying to decide, do I want to keep going with this business, or can I get the support that I need from city government or from other programs? But it's also important to look at what is tangible and what's available. So when we come back, let's take a closer look at maybe some first steps that new entrepreneurs can take, and then those that are looking at growing and expanding their business, the resources that are available for them here in the city of Pittsburgh. Are you looking for a way to advertise your business, product, or service? Why not do it here on Hustle and Heart TV? We'd be happy to send you our media kit for show sponsorship and advertising. Reach out to us at info@darieth.chisolm.com or give us a call at 412-692-1600 and we'll send you a media kit with all the information. When it comes to food, family, and tradition, Atria's is your dining destination. Atria's has a passion for food, and it all starts with our culinary trained chefs. From the made-from-scratch rubs and dressings to the best-in-the-burr crab cakes, Atria's prides itself in serving honest and real food. Come and see what makes us different at one of our 8 locations. We're now offering private dining, to-go, and full-service catering. Don't miss our 17th annual Oktoberfest starting September 8th, where you'll enjoy the most authentic German cuisine that Pittsburgh has to offer. Atreus, we're always changing courses. CTC Booking Travel and Entertainment Cruise Productions, the world's leader in full ship charter music cruises, announces 5 cruises featuring the best in jazz music entertainment. The Signature Cruise, Smooth Jazz Cruise, The Jazz Cruise, 80s Cruise, and Gospel Music Cruise. Sail for 7 days with the finest music and entertainment artists in the world. Go to jazzcruisecatalog.com and book your cruise today.
Hello, I'm Dr. Vonda Wright. I'm an orthopedic surgeon and the medical director of the UPMC Lemieux Sports Complex. And I'll see you on the next episode of Hustle and Heart TV with Darieth Chisolm.
I'm so excited about the growth and the expansion and just the entrepreneur spirit here in the city of Pittsburgh. What are some of the resources that you might offer or can offer in terms of information for new small business owners?
Well, I think it's important to understand that the city of steel is now the city of learning. And these large institutions that we have, the universities, also provide services to people who aren't students. They're a part of the community and they want to be able to help. Entrepreneurs have great resources. At the University of Pittsburgh, a program that's been created for decades now, allows an entrepreneur to come in, an analysis to be done, a mentor to be brought on to help a small business to get started. You know, you're still going to have that idea. You're still going to have the resources behind that idea to help to see something happen. But as you go through the jungle, it's important to have a guide who's already been through it. And through the University of Pittsburgh, you can have that. If you're a women-owned business, there's an additional resource over at Chatham University, where businesses can get expert advice, the assistance in helping to get through the regulations and the different parts that may seem burdensome to some, to be almost a detriment to trying to start your own business, and help to guide you with a network of other women to help you to get your business not only started, but to succeed.
And I know there's another program that the city is going to be launching soon, but I would like to share with our viewers that Rebecca Harris, who is the director over at Chatham, we featured on a previous episode of Hustle and Tart TV, and she gave some incredible information and resources, so you can easily find that episode just by going to the website, hustleandhearttv.com, and then searching Rebecca Harris or Chatham, and you'll be able to watch that episode and really tune into some of the great information that Rebecca shared. But the city is soon to be launching a new program.
Yeah, so we were selected in 2014 as one of seven cities around the country for something that's called Code for America, which means young digital experts, young coders, come to a city that has a challenge and they help to develop a digital solution to that challenge. So for so many years, the way that we purchase services and products has been Byzantine. And in fact, not even that, it borderlines on corrupt because it's a limited audience that knows how to do it. Contracts are written in certain ways that really allow some not even to be able to be a part of the process. And then a selection process is done where so many people say, I'm just not even going to try. So what we did is we worked to create Beacon. And what Beacon is it's an online ability for any company to be able to bid on city services. We've taken all the barriers out and made it very simple. So let's say you hang drywall and you want to bid on some work that the city's doing and some drywall contracts. You're able to go on, you're able to say what your specific service is, and you're able to see contracts that are coming up that you can do a bid. But more importantly, when the next contract comes, you don't have to look through the newspaper every day. Because we know that you're a drywall company that's interested, we'll send you the bid, and we'll let you know so that you can bid on the next contract. Now, that's good, but when you have contracts that are written and they're for 400 units, that limits the number of people that you start to have bids. So what we're looking to do is to break the contracts down, 20 contracts for 20 units, so that we can get small businesses to start to be able to bid. What's that going to do? More competition. What's more competition do? Lowers the price, gets more people involved in doing city contracts, helps them to get a foothold in and expand their businesses. So what we're looking to do is using our contracting system as a way to get small businesses that have never decided to bid on government work before an opportunity to have a seat at the table.
And they don't have to go through the red tape to become certified to do business with the government.
We are consolidating all of the certification processes from the Urban Redevelopment Authority, the Housing Authority, Pittsburgh Water and Sewer Authority, all under one, so that you would only have to register once and you'll be recognized as a minority or women-owned business.
Now, how can people get information about that now, or is this something that is not available just yet?
Not available just yet, but under the city's website, they'll be able to go to Beacon, and Beacon will be the web page to be able to register, to be able to see the contracts that are out there, and to be able to get the notifications of when another contract's coming due.
Mayor, that could make a world of difference for a small business owner who is really just trying to get enough jobs or enough work to keep their business going, to have the opportunity to go right to the website, put their information in, and then be able to pick up a couple of contracts. Could just keep them in the game until they get additional work.
So the coders didn't come in and decide, well, we know how to make things digital, and we'll just do it under the system that's there. They met with the small businesses. They met with those that have felt that they never had a fair shot on bidding on a contract. They met with those that never even bid on a contract because of the way the system was, and they changed the system.
That sounds like a winner for so many small business owners who will have the opportunity to do that.
And once it launches in Pittsburgh, watch what happens in cities around the country, because we all watch each other. And just as an entrepreneur has to be innovative in order to have their product purchased, a city has to be innovative in order to have people to see it as a city they want to be
in. And this is the brainchild of the city of Pittsburgh. This is starting here and could have the opportunity to spawn out into other cities and duplicate.
At the end of September, it will be launched in San Francisco, and it will be branded Pittsburgh.
That's fantastic. Yeah. Great. What are some of the other things that you're looking forward to as it relates to supporting small business here?
Well, I think the one that I spoke of before is working hand in hand to be able to restore our neighborhood business districts and provide incentives to entrepreneurs to open up businesses here. Another one is looking for strategic partnerships between the large institutions, the hospitals, the universities, to get locally owned businesses as a part of what they have. So if it's a card shop in a hospital, not having it bid out to a company out of Texas, but looking for a local business to be able to have a storefront within that hospital or in the university, in all of our large nonprofit institutions. We're looking at creating opportunities when we think about the redevelopment of this, the terminal building in the Strip. How can we create a Pittsburgh products stop, a shop? You know, there's opportunities to have high-end Pittsburgh products that are uniquely Pittsburgh in a building that would also have a produce terminal and other goods, and basically allowing people to have tens of thousands of visitors per day that would be able to see their product. And we're always looking for new ideas. So ideas that some entrepreneur dreams of, where they have the opportunity to partner with the city. We're a city that's open for business, and we want to be able to have that two-way conversation with people who are looking to locate their business in the city.
Yeah, one piece, final piece of information or inspiration that you might offer to someone who's out there hustling and making their dreams come true with their business.
I think it's a simple thing. It's never stop trying. Never stop moving forward. There will be setbacks. That happens in every business. And a lot of the most successful entrepreneurs failed several times before they were ever successful, and many times with the same product. So the greatest goal that you can do is to never give up on yourself. And if you have that belief in yourself and you work hard, eventually the time will come where it will succeed.
Absolutely. And the time is now for people who are dreaming about building business or moving forward in that space. And so we appreciate the time that you spent with us here on Hustle and Tar TV. We'd love for you to share this episode. So if you've enjoyed it, and we certainly hope that you have, you'll be sure to share it across all of your social media platforms and with your friends and family. And thank you so much, Mayor, for being here on Hustle and Tar TV. We appreciate it.
Great to see you, Darieth.
And thank you for watching, everyone.
The success in selling your home and getting the right price lies in the crux of your agent's ability to maximize your home's exposure to the largest number of qualified buyers. Each year, Dion Malish helps a family buy or sell a home every 5.5 days, so she's confident that her proven home selling strategies will sell your home. Dion and her team are not your traditional real estate agents. Unlike many agents who pound a yard sign, post to the MLS, then sit back and wait for your home to sell itself, Dion uses a proven, repeatable system to sell your home for up to 18% more in less time. Dion recently published 25 Tips for Selling a Home in Pittsburgh, which is also available on Amazon. If you're thinking of selling your home, you can get a free copy by visiting www.25tipspittsburgh.com. You can also contact her at 724-554-3514 or email her at dion@northwood.com.
The award-winning Savoy restaurant has become synonymous with fine dining, upscale ambiance, and a great destination for local and national celebrities to enjoy the night in style. The Savoy has won multiple Savor Pittsburgh Awards for its delicious menu. Our wine list was awarded Wine Spectator's 2012 Award of Excellence, and the Savoy has also won the American Institute of Architects People's Choice Award for its beautiful architecture and design. For dinner reservations and more info, log on to savoypgh.com.